Thank you. Over the last several years, I've become very, very concerned and frightened by the significant increase in anti-Semitism around the world and certainly also in our own country.
When they said Jews will not replace us, that bothered me. And what bothered me even more, that there were no consequences to any of those people afterwards.
The public has to react. It's all dangerous. You have to speak out against it.
I hope some days people grow up and just throw away that bitterness and treat people, every in each one, in the same level.
Skills used to survive in the Holocaust do indeed also apply in everyday life today.
The acts that I saw started with trivial, small items. There was a sign on the park bench that said, "This bench is not for Jews." It didn't take long for those acts to grow into gas chambers. The thing that I think society should learn is that bigotry, racial hatred can't be tolerated even at the very beginning.
I think you have to be informed what's going on, know your resources.
I survived, and the reason was that my parents had a close friends, a Christian family. Man of the family, Dr. Schultz, he was the chief judge in our city. He had information when they were going to come and pick up the Jewish people in town. And he had a way to inform us in advance. Later on, I mean, I figured it out over the years that there was a problem also on the part of the Jewish community. We were very insulated. We did not really understand the value of mingling with other people around us. And that was a big mistake.
Overall, the people from the world should care for each other. I don't care what denomination you are. I care for humanity.
Beyond that, I think each and every one of us needs to take a stand. I also recommend to students I speak to that they attend town halls that are sponsored by congresspeople and U.S. senators to make our voices heard.
We need more empathy in the world. The goal is to reach out and share our common values.
Well, my advice would be to our Jewish people in this country, please get out of your house and look for other people and befriend them. They are no different from us, and I think it would be a very healthy thing for us.
Whom you meet and you want to talk to them. Very important.
I have a lot of hope and a lot of faith in our country.
I feel pretty good about our future here. Even though with what's going on, we need to be aware of it. We need to be a little bit cautious. We need to keep our eyes and ears open.
I think we have to have hope. We've got some amazing people out there.
I am very glad that the Anti-Defamation League has stood up and confronted these hate groups that exist in our country.
We've got a lot of strengths in this community, in this country. So I recommend bring your talents and let's together work on this world and make it a better, safer place.
Welcome. My name is Elisa Moran. I'm the chair of the board of the ADL Mountain States region, which includes Colorado, Wyoming, and New Mexico. Although it's been over a year since we've been able to gather in person, we are so thankful that we have the opportunity to gather as a virtual community for ADL's 40th annual Governor's Holocaust Remembrance Program. We thank our generous sponsors, including our prime sponsors, Barry and Gay, Curtis Lesher, Michael and Debbie Finer and the Finer Family Foundation, M.B. Glassman Foundation, and MDC Richmond American Homes Foundation, as well as the many members of our honorary host committee and community partners that were shown on the slides earlier. Please visit our website at mountainstates.adl.org to see the full list and to share the remarkable video that just played with your family and friends. For 40 years, ADL has worked together with each sitting Colorado governor to memorialize the victims of the Holocaust, to honor Holocaust survivors, and to pass on the lessons that we've learned. Today, we are honored to share with you the remarks from Colorado's Governor Jared Polis. Our program features a keynote interview with Holocaust survivor Judith Altman, who will share her miraculous story of survival amidst harrowing odds. We look forward to hearing from her later in the program. Each year, we invite one of our community rabbis to deliver an invocation and one of our community cantors to chant the memorial prayer. We welcome Rabbi Bertie Becker, Rabbi Emerita of Temple Emmanuel in Pueblo, Colorado, and Cantor Saul Rosenthal, Cantor Emeritus of Congregation Rodef Shalom in Denver, who's also a former ADL Mountain States Regional Director.
God of life, God of death, who blew into humankind your holy breath, strengthen us to stand against evil and hate. Help us to build up a more humane state where we open our hearts and accept as real that both sides of living can hurt and can heal. One bothers our soul and distresses our being when it stays. We know we can handle the sting. The other gives hope and solace and love. When taken from us, the heavens above close, although we're told that to cries and to tears, the gates never close. Prayers fall on the ears of heaven's architect, whose arms carry us and whose eyes detect our woes and our fears. Healer of anger and mender of harm, let us know when to sound the alarm that we have moved from your warm embrace and are slipping into a state of disgrace. We remember the millions whose lives have been lost. Platitudes can't serve, and words can exhaust the years of slogans for the uninformed and the efforts expended to deny each storm as it grows. For we know that we cannot be blind to events of anguish, to our own or to others, whose experiences languish and seem to flow into times unassuming, uncomfortable, unimaginable, unconscionably resuming. God of memory, God of forgiveness, forgive us when our memories evade and delude us. In times of need and in times of distress, we turn to you for a moment of rest, a moment of calm, a moment of care, a moment when friends and family appear and we know that life will continue, individual but not alone, communal but not funereal. While this day remains to underscore the length and breadth and depth of horror to which humankind can ever sink, let us never again bring to the brink the complete undoing of our humanity by slipping into another insanity of divorcing ourselves one from another. We are responsible, each one of us, for each other. A home for all people, Isaiah proclaimed. My sanctuary will be, said God, who remains our shelter and our helper. Around and around in the spiral of living, once more toward the sacred, once more toward believing that we can achieve the good life we strive for and work for and die for. God of life, God of death, creator of life who breathed into us breath, dear God of hope, dear God of might, in every encounter and throughout creation, let us seek your compassionate light. Amen.
Rachamim shochem bamerumim hametzem nucha nechona tachat kanfei ashefina b'mahalot kedoshim uteharim Kezawararakia, mazirim, lenishmot kol acheinu b'nei Yisrael shenitbechu v'ashoah, anashim, Nashim vetav shenekneku v'shenisrefu v'neregu shemaseru et nafsham al kiddush Hashem b'gan Eden tehei menuchatam Anna Obal Harachamim Hastirein b'seiter kinafecha le'olamim Utsror bitsror hachayim Et nishmotechem Adonai Ve'yanuchu v'shalom ale mishkevoteihem v'nomar, v'nomar, amen. Exalted, compassionate God, grant infinite rest in your sheltering presence among the holy and pure to the souls of our brethren who perished in the Shoah, men, women, and children of the house of Israel. May their memory endure and inspire deeds of charity and goodness in our lives. May their souls thus be bound up in the bond of life. May they rest in peace. And let us say, Amen.
The governments of many countries perpetrated the Holocaust. As a result, it is especially gratifying that Governor Polis, the head of Colorado's state government, joins us in recognition of the need for remembrance and education about the Holocaust. Prior to being elected governor in 2018, Jared Polis was a successful entrepreneur who served on Colorado's State Board of Education and then went on to represent Colorado's 2nd Congressional District in the U.S. House of Representatives. Governor Polis is a Colorado native. He lives in Boulder with his partner, Marlon Reese, and their two children. We now welcome Colorado's first Jewish governor, Jared Polis, to share his message.
Hello, I'm Governor Jared Polis, and I'm so grateful that I'm able to speak with you virtually today at this year's ADL Holocaust Remembrance event. With every passing year, more and more survivors of the Holocaust pass away, adding to the list of souls we continue to honor and the importance of Holocaust remembrance across the generations. Stories from survivors here and gone, like the incredible Fanny Starr, who we lost this last year, inspire us all and keep history alive and prevent it from happening again. In times like this, their sentiments are as important as ever, and the warnings are more urgent in our time. Images of mobs spewing hateful rhetoric and resorting to violence aren't just relics of old history books. Even today, waves of anti-Semitic and racist rhetoric and violence have reached even our nation's capital and are present in many communities. It's our responsibility as elected leaders to hold a mirror up to hate and stand up against injustices and dangerous bigotry wherever and whenever they occur. The words of those who've been through hell and back, like Judith Altman, a 96-year-old Czech Holocaust survivor who you'll hear from today, echo this great responsibility across the generations. Judith said, quote, "Teach your children right from wrong. If they see anything that is not correct, stand up and don't say it doesn't concern me, because it does. People saw us being taken away from our home. No one said anything. No one spoke up against it. So I recommend that you don't just let it go. It does concern you. If you see any injustice, stand up and do something," end quote. A huge part of that is making Holocaust and genocide education a priority to inform and remind future generations of the great mistakes of humans in the past. The critical history recounted by survivors like Judith and tragically those who didn't survive that 150-mile death march from Essen, Germany to the Bergen-Belsen concentration camp will not be erased. Holocaust and genocide education in our public schools, the bill I signed was so important, and I was proud to sign it with bipartisan support. It's a step in the right direction, but it's only a small part of the site. We must continue to remember those who were involved, honor the ones we lost along the way, and fight to ensure that we never reach that point of divide again. To everyone in attendance, thank you for letting me speak with you today, and look forward to Remembrances Days in the future when we can safely be together in person.
Thank you, Governor Polis. We also appreciate the proclamation that you have signed, recognizing this to be Holocaust Remembrance Week. You may read the proclamation on our website, mountainstates.adl.org.
Hello, my name's Scott Levin. I'm the regional director of the ADL Mountain States region. We are proud to recognize the winners of the 2021 ADL Student Essay Contest. We call it A Tribute to Moral Courage, Standing Up Against Injustice. Using the Holocaust as a backdrop, middle and high school students were encouraged to recognize those individuals throughout history who took a strong stand on a specific issue based on their personal beliefs or convictions, regardless of the danger or threat to their personal safety. 18 judges had the difficult task of narrowing down to just 6 winners from over 150 essays submitted from our region. The judges determined these students stood out not only for their writing and research, but particularly for their personal reflections on how extraordinary examples of moral courage by individuals during the Holocaust and other times in history impact their own actions today. And now to the winners. In our 7th to 9th grade category, our third place winner is Anastasia P. She's an 8th grade student at Wellington Middle School in Wellington, Colorado. Anastasia's essay, The Life, Death, and Legacy of Marielle Francisco da Silva, focused on this Brazilian politician and human rights activist who was tragically murdered in 2018. In explaining why she chose to write about da Silva, Anastasia wrote, "She inspires me to help change how the world sees its people and fight for those who cannot fight for themselves." Marielle was able to take what was supposed to make her weak and turn that around and built herself up stronger. Our second place winner in this category, Heather K, is an 8th grade student at Denver Jewish Day School in Denver, Colorado. Heather's essay, Defining American Democracy, focused on Alice Stokes Paul, an American suffragist who is one of the primary strategists of the campaign for the 19th Amendment to the United States Constitution, which gave women the right to vote. Heather explained her resonance with this topic as follows. While I may only be in middle school, I believe that it is never too early or too late to begin leaving your legacy through small actions such as showing kindness, compassion, integrity, empathy, and loyalty to those around me. Our first place winner in the 7th to 9th grade category is Braylee M. She's an 8th grade student at Holy Family Catholic School in Grand Junction, Colorado. Her essay, A Light in the Darkness, focused on Helmut Kleinecke, a German engineer who supervised construction projects at Auschwitz, putting him in the position to save Jews. Braylee chose to write about this Righteous Among the Nations designee because, as she said, Helmut Kleinecke made a morally courageous decision to risk his own life for the Jewish people. His story makes me ask myself, when someone can risk their lives for others, why can't I do something as simple as accepting others regardless of our differences? The answer is simply, I can. We now turn to our 10th to 12th grade winners. Third place winner Kaylee C. is a 10th grade student at North Glen High School in North Glen, Colorado. She chose Holocaust rescuer Irina Sendler as her subject. In describing why she chose to focus on Ms. Sendler for her essay, which is titled Irina Sendler, A Hero in Disguise, Kaylee said, I feel like I've been given a lot of opportunities to change the world, and Sendler has taught me that I need to not take those opportunities for granted. I need to use them to the best of my ability. Our second place winner in this category, Gianna T., is also a 10th grade student at North Glen High School. Her essay, Offering a Hand to a Stranger, highlights Cameroonian lawyer and LGBTQ rights activist Alice Nakome. In describing why she chose Ms. Nakome as her subject, Gianna writes, I learned to take Nakome's lessons in my life because she is teaching that a problem doesn't have to be yours in order to fix it. We should explore new things we might have otherwise been wary about despite the labels attached to them. And finally, in a sweep for the 10th graders at North Glen High School is our first place winner, Damaris V. The essay that Damaris did is Change in Society. It focuses on Alicia Garza, co-founder of the international Black Lives Matter movement. According to Damaris, Garza has inspired me to stand up for people and to fight for them as well. I am Mexican, and even though racism towards Latinos is not often talked about, it occurs every day. Congratulations to this year's A Tribute to Moral Courage Student Essay Contest winners. We thank the participating teachers and families for guiding their students to write, research, and reflect on their own lives through this process. We encourage everyone to read the full essays that are on our website at mountainstates.adl.org. Newly liberated survivors of the Buchenwald concentration camp reportedly displayed the words never again. They did so on handmade signs. Like them, we must commit to interrupting actions, large and small, that can lead to harassment, violence, and murder for no other reason than one's identity. As we mark the Holocaust, we remember the harassment, violence, and murder of 6 million Jews and 5 million others. And we honor the survivors who, through courage, fortune, and/or providence, escaped those horrors and survived despite, or perhaps because of, their immutable identity as Jews. Centuries of anti-Semitism based on myths, lies, and stereotypes enabled an era when Jews were compared to rats that carried contagion and disease, to an era when the Nuremberg laws were passed for the protection of German blood and German honor, to an era when the wave of violence and terror that became known as Kristallnacht, the night of broken glass, could have even happened. On that horrific night, paramilitary brown shirts destroyed Jewish-owned homes, businesses, and synagogues. And after a decade of such Nazi actions, to an era when the so-called final solution could become the official policy of the state. Now Jews no longer face the pogroms of the 19th and 20th centuries, but we still face a time when people can be shot and killed while visiting a Jewish community center in Kansas, a kosher market in Paris, or synagogues in Pittsburgh and Poway. We still live in a time when the most cherished words of white supremacists are their 14 words. We must secure the existence of our people and a future for white children. Today, white supremacists no longer feel the need to cover their faces with white sheets, and Nazis no longer wear their intimidating brown shirts. Today's paramilitaries, the Proud Boys, Oath Keepers, and others, they've traded in those clothes for polo shirts and Camp Auschwitz t-shirts as they march through Charlottesville and storm the United States Capitol. The deaths of six women of Asian descent in Atlanta causes us to look at a history of persecution of Asian Americans and Pacific Islanders simply because of their identity. As it does with Jews, America has a long history of hateful rhetoric and policies, from the Yellow Peril and Chinese Exclusion Act of the 19th century to the internment of Japanese Americans during the 20th century. And now they have become targets as a result of elected officials and pundits who pointedly describe COVID-19 as the China virus and the China flu. Is it any wonder that acts of harassment, violence, and death have occurred against their community, just as they once did against Jews alleged to be carriers of contagion and disease? Not surprisingly, the haters have linked our two communities together as they blame us both for causing coronavirus and assert Jews are profiteering from the vaccines that are our best chances of beating it. Tonight, as we remember those lost and honor those who survived the worst genocide in modern history, we must fully commit to the term never again, just as those survivors of Buchenwald did. We must recognize never again is more than a slogan. It's a prayer for all people. I ask that you remember the wise words of Elie Wiesel. Never again is more than a slogan. It's a prayer, a promise, a vow. There will never again be hatred, never again jail and torture, never again the suffering of innocent people or the shooting of starving, frightened, terrified children, and never again the glorification of base, ugly, dark violence. It's a prayer. So I ask that we all pray. We pray that Jews, African Americans, Latinos, Indigenous peoples, the LGBTQ, Asian Americans and Pacific Islanders, and others that are the targets of hate never again face harassment, violence, and murder because of who they are. I am so fortunate to have the opportunity to share in a conversation with Holocaust survivor Judith Altman. Judy is 96 years old. She was born in Jasina, Czechoslovakia, which was invaded by the Nazis in 1939, when she was just a teenager. In 1944, Judy was arrested and taken to Auschwitz. Out of 24 family members, only she, her niece, and a nephew survived. Judy survived two forced labor camps despite a catastrophic injury and endured a 150-mile death march that ended in the Bergen-Belsen concentration camp. Sick with typhus, Judy was barely alive when she was liberated by the British Army in 1945. After living for a short time in Sweden, Judy immigrated to the United States in 1948. Judy is a member of the Holocaust and Human Rights Education Speakers Bureau and is vice president of the Holocaust Child Survivors of Connecticut. Judy, welcome. And we really so appreciate your being part of the Governor's Holocaust Remembrance Program. How are you today?
And thank you. Very well.
Good.
Very honored to be picked.
Oh, thank you. Judith, I think people would be very interested in hearing your story. Could you tell us a little bit about what life was like in Jasnia before the Holocaust?
Yasina, yes. It was a wonderful, wonderful life. We lived very harmoniously with all our, there were Czechs, there were Ruthenians, there were Hungarians, there were some Germans. But we had absolutely no discrepancy with anyone. My father, you want me to tell more about my story?
Oh, absolutely.
Well, my father had a general store, and what happened, they came and shopped, and we knew each other. Everybody, you know how many children they had, you know what happened when the wedding is and all that. It was very friendly.
How many Jews lived in your town?
There were 15,000 inhabitants in Jasina. About a third of it was a Jewish religion.
Oh, and can you tell people where Jasina is located?
It is in the Carpathian Mountains. It's actually the last city we called as Jasina do Aše Republika Naše. Jasina was the most east part, and Uš was the last one of Czechoslovakia, the old one.
So it was near Hungary then? Is that, it was close to the border?
It was bordering Hungary, Romania, and Poland.
And what kind of shop did your family have?
A general store, Obchod s Mieszaniem Zbożim. It was called a store with mixed products.
And who shopped there?
Well, we lived 6 kilometers from the town. So all the people in that area were actually our customers.
And so that would be Jews and non-Jews, right?
Not too many Jews. There were three Jewish families, and only two of them were really close that they shopped in our store. But all the Ruthenians, the Hungarians, and the Czechs prior to that, of course, shopped in our store.
And did people know that your family was Jewish?
Yeah, of course. There was no question about it.
And as you said, people got along. That wasn't an issue when you were a young girl.
Not at all. In fact, they came. We also sold the alcohol. At 1 o'clock at night, somebody knocks on the window, and my father's name was Hersch, so they call him Herschko. Knock on the window. Yes. Well, I want a stumpel. And a stumpel is a little glass with alcohol. So he says, Michal, at 1 o'clock at night, yeah, because I have a bellyache.
So he was really, it sounds like, a friend and trusted by all of his neighbors and community.
Absolutely. Hersch, you came when they needed, something was wrong, which doctor should we go? We had two doctors in town, Dr. Bach and Dr. Tendler. So which one should we go, Hersch? Tell us.
Wow. And you went to school then in the community as well?
Yes. I'm one of six children, and we all went to the schools in town. The public, the grammar school was about 2 kilometers from our house, but the high school, Rada Mieszczanka, we call it, that was about 6 kilometers, 1 hour to walk to school.
So you got along with the other students in your class?
Very well, very well. In fact, there were two Czech boys, actually, that lived in our area. That means the three of us walked 6 kilometers to school or back. If the weather was bad, my father took the horse and the sled and brought us down to school. And on the way home, we usually walked. But in the winter, when the days were very cold and short, when we walked home, the three of us, sometimes wolves came across on the street. So what did we do? We were prepared for that. And my father got me a battery, a lamp that you just put it on. And when we pointed to the wolves, they went away.
Wow. So obviously things changed in your community over time. How old were you when things started to change for the worse?
I was 14 years old at the time that we were occupied by the Germans, actually, by the Hungarians. The part was occupied by Hungarians, which were allies to Germany. They were a Nazi regime as well.
And again, because you were very close to the Hungarian border, so these were the people that probably were in the entire region. They were taking things over. Is that right?
Well, the people, the Hungarian people that lived there for all these years, they were our friends. But the police and the gendarme, they were foreigners. And they came, they changed our life completely. We had...
How did your life change?
Completely. To begin with, we no longer could go to school. So we were in middle of our middle school, 8 years we went to school. After that, that was it. We could no longer go to school. So what did my father do? If he could hire a woman, because the men were already drafted in slave labor camp. I am sure that you have heard of that. Yeah. Every man from 18 to 45 was taken to slave labor camp. And so the women teachers, they were doing that for people.
So one day you're getting along with everyone, life looks good. And then the next day it seems like it all just turned upside down. How did that happen? Did somebody come to the store or to your house?
Yes. What they did, they came in and they said my father could no longer be in the store. They put in a Hungarian commissar, they called it, and he was the one. The proceeds from the business was going to the government, and the rest of it, it was everything for them. Whatever we had a tobacco consignment, no, what do you call
concessions,
it?
You sold tobacco, yeah.
And alcohol as well. And everything else, groceries, of everything. So we had all that, and that was, my father could no longer go into the store. They put in somebody else, and he was there. However, our house was a very long house. So it was the living room, the bedroom, the living room, and the store, and the storage. Everything in one. It was a one-floor building. And in the back was a storage room and a cellar where you go down and keep the wine and the beer and all that.
And you continued to live in the house while the commissar was running the business?
Yes, for a short while. However, later on, when the Hungarians came, the Hungarian gendarmes and army, so the Hungarian officers took over the big house, and we had to live in the summer kitchen in the back. But they came, stayed a few days, and left to the front, which the front was very near. It was actually about 4 kilometers from our house to the front.
And
to the Polish border, rather, not the front.
Were all your brothers and sisters living at home at that time, too?
Not anymore. As I said, I don't know how much time I can devote to something like that. I was the only one at that time home. I come from six. So my oldest sister was married and lived in the same town. My next siblings in line was also a sister, and she was married and she lived in Poland. She had a 3-year-old little girl and a 7-year-old boy. My following sibling was a man, and his name was Ira, and he lived in Belgium with his wife and two sons. My only lucky brother was Bernard, who came to the United States in 1939. My following brother in line was Emmanuel, a dentist. He was drafted to the slave labor camp, was 3 years in the German camp, subsequently caught by the Russians, sent to Siberia. And it took one whole year after the war is over to know that he was alive.
Wow.
And I was the only one left at home.
And you were the youngest of the six?
I'm the youngest, 10, 11 years younger than my next brother-in-law.
Oh, I see. I see. So you said for a short time you were living in the house while they occupied the store and probably the town that was going on. Then what happened next?
Then they took over because a officer, either a German officer or a Hungarian high echelon, moved in there, and we had to move into a summer building that we had in the back of our big house.
And then from there, when did you have to go then to a concentration camp?
Well, they didn't stay there all the time. They only stood a certain part and then continued to the front to Poland. So we could go in and out. However, unfortunately, my father, he had a beard. At that time, the Jewish man had a beard. And whenever the Hungarian or the German soldiers saw a Jewish man with a beard, they pulled on them and beat him up. So my father was mostly in the attic. And every day I brought food up to my father in the attic. And the officer that lived in the big building, in the house, he said, "Why are you," of course, in perfect German, which was one of my six languages, seven by now. So he said, "What are you doing on the roof?" I said, "Because my father is hiding there, because your soldiers are beating him up." He said, "As long as I am here, he does not have to do that. He can come down." But he only stayed 2 days and went to the front. So that kept.
I'm sure it was terribly difficult. And then eventually was the family taken away from the town?
Yes, it was in 1944 in April. It was one day after Passover. It was 6:30 in the morning, and two SS men and two Hungarian gendarmes knocked on our window. "You have a half hour. Take all your money, all your jewels, and come. It is a day after Passover. Jewish people have no bread in the house." And my father took his prayer shawl, his prayer book, and waited. I took my last birthday present, and I waited just under a light coat, a winter coat. "My mother isn't coming out." I said, "Mommy, why don't you come?" She says, "I don't want them to kill me. I want to do something myself." I said, "Mommy, you always have time to die." So we convinced her, and we started marching.
Had you already at that point in time heard stories of what was happening to the Jews in the area?
Yes, not in that area, but we knew what's happening because sometimes a lucky Jewish man was able to escape what happened in Poland when they were shooting them with a gun before the gas chambers.
Yeah. Did you have fear of what was ahead of you at that time?
Indeed we were, because it might have been a chance for me to get away somehow, maybe. But I did not want to leave my parents. And my father was on in years, and I was really very concerned not to leave them alone.
So where did they take you?
Well, they took us down to town. So we walked down and we were told to go up to the cemetery. And my father said, "How convenient. They're going to kill us and they don't even have to bring us to the cemetery to bury." That did not happen. We were there a whole week. But within that 1 week, he said, they gave us orders. "If you have to go back to the home, bring more jewels and more money, it will save your life." Oh.
So what did you do?
Well, we did. I we called the maid that worked for us, and we said, bring some of the jewels, and not all of them, the rest of them, make a dough and put the jewels into the dough, bake a bread, and bring it to us to the cemetery. Put the jewels separately and the bread separately. We were hoping that by being the bread, we will be able to have something on us.
And what happened next?
Well, now we are a week in the cemetery. After a week, at that point, they didn't take it away from us yet. We walked to the railroad, and we were taken to Matesolko, to a city in Hungary. There were thousands and thousands of people from Hungary, from the Czech part, from Romanian part. And we were there, thousands. The young people like we were keeping the ghetto clean. And there were about 30 to 40 families in a little house. But we were still together with our parents.
And how long were you there?
6 weeks. After 6 weeks, we were told to go to the railroad, and we were told to walk, march. We don't know yet. And take just a little satchel of food for a few hours. And we started marching. We came to the railroad, and we were put into cattle cars. I have pictures, but I didn't think that you wanted me to show them.
That's okay.
The red cattle cars, and they put in 70 to 75 people into a cattle car. It was, we were like sardines, and they gave us an empty bowl to use as a bathroom and one filled with water. And they closed it with an iron bar. There was a little tiny window on top, very little air to come in. We were there till the following morning. In the morning, the train started slowly to move. It was 4.5 days of the most horrible 4.5 days. People were dying. What do you do with the body? We sat on the body. Women were giving birth. It was the most unbelievable way. Children were screaming, they're hungry. And the SS men, at this point, we only saw SS men. If that, and then people were screaming and crying. If that doesn't stop, we will take all of you out and shoot you on the spot. So we had to tie their hands and back, tie their mouths with a kerchief to keep them quiet, because people became berserk, literally berserk.
Oh man, terrible, terrible. So 4 days of that. And then where did you end up stopping?
Well, we stopped. Well, the end destination was the 21st of May. It was my father's birthday. They opened the door and they screamed, "Raus, raus," and they throwing sick and old people, literally throw them out. We see men and women in striped uniform running back and forth. There is a big sign, Arbeit macht frei. Well, then we all say, well, Arbeit, so maybe they take us to a work camp. And we ask the men.
And why don't you tell people what does that mean, that German?
Arbeit macht frei, work will liberate you.
Yes.
All right, so we will be working. Good. But we asked the men that were there in the striped uniform, where are we? What is this? And they said, this is hell. But they gave us orders. You see, it's a huge place. You see men and women striped uniform marching with a band. They are playing a band. You are completely confused. They say, line up in row of five, women separate and men separate. There is my mother, my sister, my aunt, my niece, myself, and my aunt's three little children, 2, 4, and 6. There is the men's row, my father, my brother-in-law, my uncle, my nephew, and another man. And they say, march slowly. Here we are, the women separate in a row, the men separate. And we are going slowly towards. We come to the end of that row. And we stand in front of a German officer. This is Dr. Joseph Mengele. He was called the angel of death. He was to determine who shall live and who shall die. He came to our row. He pointed to my niece to go to the left, to me to go to the left. And the rest of them are marching to their death. We are going to the left and they were to the left, to the right. And as I passed my father's row, he put his hand on my head as he did every Friday night to bless us. He said, Judy, you will live. These were the words that kept me going.
I can't even imagine how terrible that was. How long were you in that camp?
Actually, we were there a year and 5 months or something like that. But you know, some things you want to black out in your mind.
Absolutely. And that's understandable. Can you just give us just a little tiny brief glimpse into what life was like in the camp?
Oh, well, we were in Auschwitz, because that was not just, unless we don't have the time to describe all that. You tell me.
No, that's okay, please. You're at Auschwitz,
Auschwitz. Now we are in Auschwitz, so we are standing after we were selected. We are at that point, we sit down and a man cuts our hair completely bald. After that, we are given a little piece of soap. We stand in front of a door where it says bath. In our case, it was water. In our parents' case, it was gas. After the shower, now we are bald. After the shower, we are given a little piece of soap. After the shower, we are getting a gray dress, a cotton dress with short sleeves, and a pair of wooden clogs, enormous big one. And we told to stand outside in line, again, in line in row of five. The only one is there, my niece and myself from my family. I lost 24 members of my family on the 21st of May in 1944.
Wow. Just you and your niece were the only ones to come out alive. Yeah.
Well, my nephew as well, but that I didn't know at that time. So he was in the men's row. He was the only one picked there, and Ida and me in the women's row.
Wow.
But when I don't know what I said, when I passed my father's row, he said, Judy, you will live.
So that's really what kept you going.
What kept me, if my father said, he was such a pious man, if he said, I'll live, I will live.
And you were just 14 years old when you went in.
Oh, at that point, I was already 17. That's when we were, okay, sorry to...
No, that's my fault. Wow. It's still so a year and a half. And I'm sorry, was the whole time were you in Auschwitz?
Altogether, no. We were in Auschwitz only 6 weeks. But Auschwitz is for something else.
Please, yeah.
You were woken up. You come into a low building and you sit on a koyer, which is like three shelves. There is one on the bottom, only your face sticks out. The second row, only your face sticks out. And the people that are on top get actual air. We are there all day long. 6 weeks we were in Auschwitz. Then what happened? Occasionally, once a week, you are going to take a shower, which is great. However, if Mengele picked too many people and did not have a place to send them, they never come back from that shower. They go to the gas chamber. So every week there is that fear you will not make it. Incidentally, when we are in the barracks, But after we came back from the first day and we went into the barracks, there was, after a few hours, the most horrific smell, a choking smell. And we asked the girls that were there already 2 or 3 years, what is that horrible smell? There was a girl, Olga, a Czech girl. She said, these are your parents burning.
Oh,
as we went through the shower, they went through the gas chamber and immediately to the crematorium.
We just have a short while left, but after Auschwitz, where did you go?
After Auschwitz, we were taken to Gelsenkirchen, to West Germany. There we worked in factories and outside. There were 2,000 of us. 1,000 was working outside, building roads, building bunkers. The others were working in factories. Subsequently, we moved, since you say there was short time, we moved to Essen. This was Gelsenkirchen. Now we are in Essen, and there we worked as well. There, first I worked outdoors in the first group. And the second time I worked in Essen. There, a piece of iron fell on my left wrist, and it broke the arm. If you cannot work, you're being sent back to either Auschwitz or Treblinka, any place.
So how did you survive that with your wrist broken?
I'm going to tell you now. So in middle of the night, I get somebody taps me on the shoulder. It's SS woman, Erika. She called, come du kleine, come little one. And she takes me to the hospital and they put on a cast. So I ask a question. She said, don't talk. After that, she takes me to the Obersturmführer and she says, this girl is due to go to be sent back tomorrow. If we send her back, the work is not going to be done at Krupp because she speaks many languages. If the Hungarian or the Ruthenian or the Jewish girl or the Czech girl does not speak German, the work is not going to be done because she will not understand.
You translated for all of the different languages?
I did that. And so the Obersturmführer said, okay, she can stay as long as we need her. And when we don't need her, you send her back because she can't work. No, she can work. She can. So Erika says she can work, even if she hasn't got any translation to do. So what I want to say, that among the even the SS, there was some humanity.
Oh my goodness. The fact that you survived because you are so good at languages and a good worker and maybe a little bit of humanity. That's so unexpected.
And a little bit of luck.
Yeah, I'm sure of that. I'm sure of that. When were you liberated?
The 15th of April in 1945.
And who liberated you at that time?
The British. If I just want to take a little few seconds.
Sure.
I was lying there already with typhoid, unconscious with a high fever. And I hear an English language. And I said, I must be dreaming. And he said, no, you are not dreaming. You are free.
Oh my goodness. What a
wonderful, wonderful thing to hear. We never thought that we really never believed that we'll make.
Wow. So you had, you had typhus at the time, but what happened next to you? Where did you go?
It took 6 weeks actually not knowing these 6 weeks where I was very high fever and very sick. But when I opened my eyes, I was in a white bed. I sat in a white bed. What happened? Where was it? At that time, they said there was a British officer there because we were liberated by the British. And they said, you are free. His name was Captain Paul. And it was just a wonderful, wonderful, which we never believed that it's going to happen.
Wow. So how did you get from there to where you now are in Connecticut, United States of America?
Well, we were in that camp. Then they took us to another camp and they said, since I had water in my lungs and all that, very sick. So they sent us to Sweden. And I came to Sweden there. I was one whole year in the hospital being cured. I learned another language. After that, I worked 3 years in Sweden. Subsequently, 1948, came to the United States, to this wonderful country of ours. And I had a brother here. I had a grandmother here, uncles and aunts. And nobody can feel what we feel in this wonderful country, how happy we are and lucky to be here.
And you went on to become a technical writer?
Yes, my profession is a technical writer and designer, because the 3 years in Sweden, I learned that profession. Wow. So I did that. And
today you have how many children and grandchildren?
I have two sons, and each son has one daughter. And all of them very highly educated and very successful, thank God, and very happy to be in this wonderful country of ours.
I'm sure. Judy, not every survivor feels comfortable telling their story. You've been doing this for very, very long time. And why is it that you feel it's so important to tell your story?
Because it is important for the world to know what hate and discrimination and misery can do. And that's why when I speak to students, I tell them, learn all you can, because literally in me, knowing the language has saved my life. So I give them that and see that in your case, it'll be your career. In my case, it was saving my life. So study all you can and be a good citizen and love your mother and father to no end, because it is terrible not to have them.
That's so beautiful. You know, you led such a wonderful young life, then such terrible tragedy, and to lose so many people and to endure the awful things that you did. Do you think there's hope?
Indeed. That's why we have to work on the young people. Be good, do not discriminate, and discuss. If you have a problem, go to higher echelons and talk about it. That's the best way, not with a fist, but with your mind.
Oh, well, Judy, thank you so much for this time and for sharing your story. And it is something I'm certainly going to carry for a long time, and I know that our audience will too. Many blessings. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I'm really very blessed to be interviewed with such important people.
We so appreciate Judith Altman's participation in this evening's remarkable event. For more information about ADL's work and programs, including Holocaust education resources, please visit our website at mountainstates.adl.org. Thank you all for attending this 40th annual Governor's Holocaust Remembrance Program. Good night. ¶¶